Hi, welcome back to Banjo Diaries entry number 2. Thanks for coming back if you watched last month. I have practiced since I saw you last, which was on January 1st. Today's January 31st. I've practiced 20 minutes minimum every single day. Most days just 20 minutes, but occasionally I felt like playing more, and so I played more. And I've had a lot of fun doing it. I truly started looking forward to playing the banjo every day. A couple times this month, I even had, you know, plans after work, and I would think, wait, when am I gonna fit in the banjo? I can't do it before work, my family's still sleeping. And one time I arranged it to come home after work and fit in my banjo practice before going to my other engagement that I had. So it's definitely something that I've enjoyed doing every day. I've looked forward to it, and it's just kind of a part of my routine now. I fit it in when I can, depending on our schedule. So before I get into showing you how far I got this month with my plan, because these are diaries that I'm calling them, I just wanted to reflect for a minute. I was talking to a friend this month about this endeavor, and he kind of was like, why the banjo? Why not the guitar? He happens to be from Spain. Spanish guitar, of course, is beautiful and very famous. And so for him, if you're gonna play a fretted instrument, why wouldn't you play the guitar? And so I thought about that a little bit. And I realized that my experience with music, and maybe this is just me, I'm not speaking for everyone, but my experience when I hear music that is beautiful or intriguing, I have one of two reactions. One reaction is I hear music and I think, oh, you know, that's really beautiful or that's really intriguing to me. I want to hear more of it. And so I'll watch more or I'll listen to more or I'll purchase more music and I just want to hear it and take it in. The other reaction that I'll have when I'm drawn to music is I'll hear it and I'll think, that's really beautiful or that's really intriguing. I want to be a part of it. And so for me, that's the difference. And when I hear the classical guitar, I think that's beautiful. I want to hear more of it. And I really love listening. I love appreciating someone else's art on the music. And there are lots of instruments like that I could just listen to, but I'm content to just listen to them. And for me, the banjo is in the other category for some reason, and I can't explain why. When I hear the banjo, I don't want to just stop at listening. I hear it and I think, I want to be a part of that. I want to make that music and learn how to make that music. So there are certain instruments like that for me, the banjo being one. Maybe my next set of diaries will be another one that I want to learn as well. But that's kind of it, and I just feel like there's not really any rhyme or reason. There's no accounting for taste. You just are drawn to what you're drawn to, right? So for me, that's why I'm doing the banjo, because it's not enough for me just to listen to banjo. I'm not satisfied just listening. So, okay, so this month I had two tasks to work on. It was all working with my right hand, my picking hand, which I thought was gonna be more challenging to get down, because it's involving technique that I don't use when I play the cello. So I had two things to do. I had to do a pinch pattern and I had to do an alternating roll. So I'll play for you what those sounded like. So the pinch pattern sounds like this. And the alternating roll is twice that fast. So like if those were quarter notes, the alternating roll would be eighth notes and it sounds like this. Practiced that over and over and over again, day after day after day, and it got to the point where, you know, at that speed I was doing fine, but I had committed to not doing anything else for this month, to just working on those patterns and getting comfortable with them. So I didn't really have anything to do other than work on speeding up those patterns, and I tried a lot with working on getting comfortable playing them without looking at my hand, although there's not anywhere else to look because I'm not doing anything with my left hand yet. So I would just kind of stare off into space or stare at my family or stare out the window, but really trying to play them without needing to look at my hands. So I got them pretty fast. I used a metronome just because I don't have any other music to be playing with right now. I'm really limited in what I can do. So I just used a metronome to try to keep increasing the space. So I got fast. I don't know. I was playing it like maybe quarter note 175, 180 in that range. So kind of in this range. I did, as I think I mentioned in the last episode, the last Banjo Diary, I did plant only my pinky. That's what I'm definitely comfortable doing. So I feel good about it. I can do it for long stretches of time. I can talk to people, although the banjo is really loud, so it's hard to talk over it. But I'm very comfortable with it. Occasionally, my thumb will miss the fourth string. And that was the biggest challenge I had, because my thumb is going between the third string, the fifth string, and the fourth string. And just getting used to the distance and where those are. But in general, I was pretty accurate with things. So that's kind of what I worked on. Now, as the month went on, I really had to resist the desire and the urge to go on to the next lesson and start doing something else. And especially my left hand was really like lonely because I wasn't using it at all. But part of my brain was thinking, come on, you're a string player. Like, you've got this, just move it. You can do it. But I really wanted to be, committed to not rushing things and trying to get the muscle memory for the roll and what it felt like and just doing this new technique with my right hand. So I was good. I did add one other variation of the alternating roll. So if this is the alternating roll, okay, I added a variation which I got up to the same speed as all the others, which is just practices. I would rotate through all three of those patterns. So I would do the pinch and the alternating roll. For 20 minutes. So anyway, that was a lot of fun. I had a good time doing it. And what else did I do? I wanted to start like understanding more about the instrument. So I did some things. I bought a new set of strings. I felt like the strings were really old. They probably came with this instrument and needed to be repaired or replaced. So Mr. Jim Pankey, who's my YouTube instructor, has a really helpful video on how to change banjo strings. So I ordered a set of strings. Oh my goodness, so funny. So I play the cello, like I've said. For me, if I can get the strings I put on my cello, if I can buy all four of them for under $300, that's a good deal. $280, Amazon had them going the set for $280 a couple weeks ago, I just checked. But a lot of times it's over $300 for the set I use. So I was thinking, oh my gosh, this is a five string instrument. Like what is a new set of strings gonna cost me? No joke. I looked up the recommended top strings to get for banjo. I bought like the number two on the list of these strings, and it's a brand that Mr. Pankey even says he uses. $6.95 for all five strings, $6.95. So it cracked me up, the difference in the cost of these steel strings from what I put on my cello. So anyway, I bought the strings, they came, I watched a video on how to change them. It really brightened up the sound of the instrument, and it was good for me to learn how to do that. The video was super helpful. So I did that. I learned how to take the resonator off the instrument. So I took the resonator off, dusted it out, it was kind of dusty, and just kind of learned a little bit about the makeup of the instrument. Also learned how to adjust my bridge. I don't know if you can see, but the bridge is not straight on this banjo. So what happens is, in order to, when you tune up the banjo, depending on the angle of your bridge, the banjo might be in tune for the strings to be open, but then when you start fretting the strings and playing with your left hand, they're not, it doesn't always stay in tune. So you have to find the right angle of the bridge for the banjo to be in tune, both open and fretted. So I did that, and so that's what it looks like on this instrument. If you notice, it's not a straight bridge, but it's in tune. If I play notes fretted, they're in tune regardless. So I just kind of got to know the instrument, and I did do a little bit of picking, I confess. Just to try to, again, get to know, because the geography is so different, this instrument is not tuned at all like a cello. Cello is tuned in fifths. So my brain, it makes sense in my brain, if I'm playing an instrument tuned in fifths, even the violin or the viola, I can do the same thing. I know exactly when I need to switch to the next string or when I need to shift up higher to play certain notes. I know what notes are across the string because that's my brain just understands an instrument tuned in fifths. The banjo is not tuned in fifths at all. So I just need to start learning, like, where are notes? Like, where can I find them? So I watched a video, I told you last episode, that I really hope to learn dueling banjos. And so I watched another video from Mr. Pankey. He has so many helpful videos that kind of broke down dueling banjos. I just watched it because I was curious about it. That's where the variation of the alternating roll came from, was that video. He actually plays that in dueling banjos when he's going against the, when he's putting rhythm behind the guitar part. He plays that. So I wanted to start learning that. And then I just started picking some of the melody out. To learn where notes are on the banjo. So like, just like, just the melody that you guys have heard, right? And then I learned how to shift up. I don't know if it's called shifting on the banjo, it probably is. So I come up to the fifth fret and bar that. And even up to the seventh fret to change keys again. So I had a little bit of fun doing that, just again to start my brain understanding where notes are on this instrument, and that's gonna come. I know that's gonna come. So that's kind of what I did this month. So what is my goal for next month? Finally, I have a task for my left hand. My left hand is going to work on two things, just like I had two jobs for my right hand. I've got two jobs for my left hand. One is called a slide, and so it's I'm using my second finger, and you're gonna play on the second fret and then slide to the fourth fret. And so it sounds like this. Sorry, that's just a one fret slide. I'm not good at it yet. Okay, it sounds like that. So apparently slides are a big thing with banjo music, with bluegrass music, so. So I'm gonna work on that. And then the other is called a hammer-on, which is where you play the string and then hammer your finger on. And it's also the second fret, but it's on the fourth string. The slide is on the third string, okay? All right, so that's what I'm working on. I have to get comfortable with those. I have to get used to the feel of doing those over frets because I don't play an instrument with frets. So the bumping, I think it's gonna give me a lot of calluses on that finger. I'm just getting used to sliding over it. And then I'm going to incorporate the slide and the hammer-on into the pinch pattern and the alternating roll that I did this month. So after I get used to the left hand and just drilling that over and over, then I actually put them in to the patterns that you already heard me play. So that's what I'm doing this month. I think I'll devote all of February to that, but if I feel like I pick it up really quickly, full disclosure, I might allow myself to move on to lesson three, but we'll see. Maybe I'll just stick with it. Maybe I'll keep this pace of kind of one lesson per month. So I will let you know, and I will be back in a month. Thank you for coming back and listening to my progress, and I will see you in another month as a more accomplished banjo player. Bye.